Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 43 for the 22nd of May, 2022. This week we're finishing up the series on the Singer 15-91 that I've been doing for the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association thrift shop located in Leonardo, New Jersey. Tomorrow, Thursday, in the evening, we're going to be going down to the thrift shop, reinstalling the machine in the cabinet, and presenting her back to the management of the thrift shop. So you'll see at the end of this video, there'll be some video of that as well. Anyway, get your coffee going, kick back, enjoy. Okay, we're getting into the home stretch. Once again, we're working on this 15-90 that belongs to the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. Actually, it belongs in their thrift shop. And we are almost done. We just got to do this crap in here. Do all the needle bar box stuff. And you can see how filthy she is. And oh, I wish you could feel how tough this is getting to move this adjuster. This does not want to give it up. But we got the underside done. We got all that cleaned and ready to rock and roll. Got the stitch length regulator mechanism put back in place. We've done quite a bit on this old gal. Man, is this stuff dirty. So, we're going to do a little bit more on this piece. All right, that's out. We're going to pop the oil wick out of here. What's left of it anyway. Just a little tiny piece. That's all that's left of the wick. Okay, and I'm going to pop off, loosen the set screw, see if I can get this out. I'll loosen up a bunch of stuff here. Okay, take the set screw out completely. A lot of this stuff is just so grungy. There we go. Let me get this needle plate back off again. That still hasn't been cleaned. Although everything underneath it has. You see here that this needle clamp doesn't want to come off very well either. I got the screw out completely and it's still not moving. So what's that tell you? I know what it tells me. Likewise, that ain't a moving very well. Oh, the washer just popped out. Very good. Let's see if we can get the spring out. Spring is out. All right. So I'm going to give a little tapiology to loosen the presser bar up a little bit. Okay, and there we go. That's a coming. And then we'll just pry that up a little bit more. Give it a little bit more tapping. I have put no lubricant on this whatsoever. Okay. Take a big gigantic screwdriver. We'll take the take-up lever out. This is not necessarily the order I normally take this apart. Not that it really makes much difference at this point. Right now, I just want to get the parts out of the machine. And go. That's out. You can see the amount of crud and rust on these parts. It's pretty horrible. lift her out. Come on, baby. There she goes. She's out now. There we are. Look at how grungy that is. These are some grungy parts. And all right, now get the needle bar all the way down. Get our screwdriver in the back. See if we can find the. All right, there she goes. She's loose now. Loosened up. Boy, this doesn't want to give it up either. Turn her around. I'm going to tighten that back up and get that clamp off because I am not going to take the hook off of this thing again. Okay, clamp is back on. Let me tap that down. I'm just lightly tapping. I'm not wailing on this. There we go. A little bit of light tapiology, and this is just so crudded up and rusted in place. All right, get that all the way back down. Loosen that. See if we can get the needle bar up and out. Yeah, we got to loosen that a little bit more. Come on, girl. There you go. And pop her up and out. It is getting that wick out of the top. All right. Okay. I'm going to put a little bit of penetrating oil on it. This is actually what was left of a can of Aerocroil. I couldn't get it. There wasn't enough aerosol left for the last of the can. There was about an ounce or so left in the bottom of the can. There was no way I was going to waste it. Because if you've ever looked at the prices of Aerocroil, it's a little expensive. So, here we go. We're up and out. Ta-da! All right, we can just lift this out. And this, my friends, is grunge. Look at how filthy that is. All right, let's see what we got inside here. And that's pretty dirty as well. Now, I normally don't do this, but somebody's got to. I'm going to take the bushing out. That's not a good size screwdriver for that. That is not much of a set screw. That is probably one of the shallowest set screws you will ever see. That set screw is out. I'm going to give this a little tap. All righty. It's coming through. All right. Here we go. And it's out. And that is the upper needle bar bushing in all of its disgusting grandeur. All right, I'm going to keep a towel over, which I should have been doing before, keep a towel over this, and I'm going to get in here with a rotary tool and some cup brushes, and I'm going to blast some of this crap out of this upper section here. But before I do, I confirm, yeah, that moves nice. So what was holding this up at last was just the dirt on the needle bar and the needle bar linkages. So I'm going to get in here and pulverize some of this crud. Let me get a smaller cup brush in there as well. There you go, that did not take very long at all. Just wipe out the excess crud with some paper towel. And you'll see that that has cleaned that area up quite nicely. What that did not do, though, is it did not get the cam. The cam I'm going to do next, I'm going to go in through the side here. I'm going to rotate the cam around. Got a lot of that crap out of there, and we'll some oil on the bushings, on the bearings, I should say. There we go. Now it's just a matter of cleaning and polishing parts. One thing I am going to do is, you saw how much trouble the presser adjuster gave me. I'm going to run a 5/16 by 28 tap down that hole, chase those threads. That did not want to go through. So this will cut any crud that's in there and make that operate much, much smoother. And of course, I'm going to clean the male threads on the adjuster as well. But while I've got that all the way down, rather than drawing it back through there, while I've got it down here, I'm using a bottoming tap. So it was cutting threads right from the get-go, or I should say cleaning threads. I'm just going to use a stiff brush and go through and clean that off a little bit. So as I draw it back, I'm not leaving crud, or I'm minimizing what I'm leaving in the threaded hole. And once again, this is a 7/16 28. And we are out And just for grins and giggles, without cleaning this anymore just yet, let's see how that fits. Oh, and that fits so much better now. It's amazing what cleaning crud will do to make something work nice. So there we go. Once again, that's a 7/16 by 28 is the thread size. I have a set of three of them. One's taper, one's plug, and one's bottoming. And they're amongst my favorite things that I keep in my stash of cool tools. Alright, I'm going to start with getting the linkages back in place. Oh, that fits so much nicer now than it did. And backing out the screw. See how that's going to fit. Oh, much the nicer. Put a little drop of oil on that. There we go. That feels good. Little drop on there. Okay, that feels good. Now we're going to temporarily put the needle bar down and through. Because what we have to do now is we've got to get this upper bushing in place and at the right height. Now we know approximately where the needle bar is going to be. There's the ground down portion on the back of the needle bar shaft. So I'm just going to put it into that at the moment. Find it, spin it around. Okay, that should be pretty much there. Okay, there it is. It's in it. All right, the height is not yet established. But we've got to get this upper bushing in place. So the upper bushing is going to have to get tapped down. Actually, hold one. Before we do that, let me make sure the inside of this is thoroughly cleaned. Put a little bit of oil that will clean that in there. Get in here with a swab and clean this out. That's pretty clean to begin with. I just want to make sure we got all the crud out of there. And the croil will help remove that crud. All right, now I took this bushing out because I wanted to get it nice and clean. So I'm going to tap it down. And I'm not going to put it all the way. All right, what we have to do first is we have to establish the needle bar height before we can establish the final position of the bushing. So, I know this is a little tricky. I'm going to take the needle clamp and get this established. Needle bar clamp is on. I'm going to take these feed dogs off of this machine first. With the feed dog out, I'm going to install a needle and going to do it all the way up. Come on. We've got our needle bar on. We've got a needle in. We're all the way down. We're straight up and down. Timing is correct. Now what we need to do is adjust the needle bar for needle bar height. Then I'm going to have to take this bobbin case out to see what I've got. So let me swing that around, get that up. All right, bobbin case is out. Let me put that all the way down once again. There we go. That is locked in. Okay, we've got our timing set, and we have our needle bar height set. The needle bar height is set correctly when the point of the hook is approximately 1/16 of an inch above the top of the eye of the needle when the hook is in the correct timing position. It's a little tricky to do sometimes, but we've got it. This can get a little tricky. As you see, there's two lines that are engraved around the periphery of the needle bar. The upper line and the bottom line. Well, what you want to do is you want to drive that bushing down into the casting so that when the linkages are straight down, when the needle bar is in its lowest position, that that upper line is even with the bottom of the needle bar bushing. And it takes a little bit of very, very delicate tapiology to do that. And you'll see here in a moment, okay, now I've got it at the bottom of the travel, and I'm checking, and sure enough, that top line is even. And when I get the hook in its proper timed position, that lower line is even with the bottom of the bushing. That's really all there is to it, but it can be a little nerve-wracking. All right. We've got the feed dog height adjusted and locked in. We've got the needle bar height adjusted. We've got the timing adjusted. So we're pretty much in the home stretch now. So next thing I'm going to do is put in the take-up arm. Get that started. There we go. Take up arm is in. And give that a little snug. Give it a little drop of oil. Oh, this machine feels so much better than it did just a couple of weeks ago when it arrived. Okay, next up. You know what I haven't done yet? I haven't cleaned the thread cutter nor the presser foot retainer, but I'm going to hold on that for the moment, because I'm going to put the lifter, actually hold on, I'm going to put the lifting arm back in first, and it's going to just press in. Make sure that it's got plenty of flexibility, which it does. And we'll get a screwdriver here and we'll run that in. That's got plenty of. Actually, I'm gonna pull that out just a little bit. There we go. We want that to have a little bit of room to move. That's good. Get a little oil behind and inside. Actually, we're going to tighten that up just a little bit. There. There we go. That feels good. Now, there's the little matter of putting this set screw back into this block, just getting it started, getting the block in place. Dropping the presser foot down, the presser bar down. Okay, let's get the feed dogs down below, which now they are. Now I do not have, this screw is not clean, we know that, that's okay. Neither is the presser foot. The presser foot's gonna have to come off again and get clean too. We'll do that in our final. I'm going to bring the needle plate, the needle up, drop that down so that the feed dog is down. Make sure that that is centered. We're going to put just a touch of lift on that. Just a touch of lift. Like a microscopic amount. Making sure that the slot in the presser foot stays centered on that hole. We got a little bit of give there. It's not hitting, that's good. Now we'll bring that up. We'll drop our spring back down. We'll put our washer down. And oh, I haven't cleaned this. Give me 1 minute and a rotary tool. Now we went through and we re-tapped that hole to chase those threads. So that should work a lot better than it did before, and it feels so much better right now. That feels good. Good solid contact. It's a matter of a oil wick for the presser bar. I buy these saxophone key bumpers on Amazon. I cut them in half. You don't want them super big. I put them in here. They just slide in. Get that up all. What I do to make sure it's in the right spot, I get this down all the way. Put the adjuster down all the way with the foot all the way down. And then raise the presser bar. See it's sticking above a little bit? I'll take a single edge razor blade and trim that off. Just like this. Trim it off flush. There you go. It's the perfect size. You're never going to run that down all the way anyway. So when you get it up a little bit, you can kind of push it just down a little bit with your finger. And it'll be fine. And then saturate that with sewing machine oil. And you're good to go. It's going to bubble a little bit first few times you do that. Likewise, if you put a wick in on top of the needle bar. I really don't think the needle bar wick is necessary. Singer used one there. You can use a piece of felt cord. It really doesn't need to be there. You can keep that lubricated all by your lonesome without having to put anything in that. I mean, if you want to use a piece of wick, you can, but it's not really necessary. Okay, the next stage we've got left to do is to finish the button up. We've got to clean up the end plate, get the crud off of that, and clean the upper thread tension assembly, and then do final adjustments. Put the motor back on, make final adjustments of the feed dogs in the needle plate, and we're pretty much ready to rock and roll. Well, this machine can go back to the thrift store at the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. I went ahead and I took the end plate apart and the upper thread tension mechanism apart. I put all the components into my ultrasonic cleaner. And I must say I am very happy with the way it came out. The only two parts I didn't put in were these two screws. I kind of figured I'd lose them if I did. So anyway, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to start reassembling the upper thread tension onto the end plate here. It's easy enough to do. Once again, once you know how, it's very simple to do. I'm going to put a little bit of oil on the pin. And drop that down. Okay, that's in. Now, this, of course, is not going to be adjusted at this point. That's okay. All right. Actually, it's going to be pretty close. Get that so that's horizontal, which it is. And that's all the way in place. Disc. Disc. All right. I'm going to angle that a little bit. Right there is fine. Beehive. Set that between 2 and 3. And let's get our I could really care less about numbered dials personally, but I know a lot of people like them. Oh my goodness, this machine is looking so much better. It's hard to believe this is the same machine. Well, she's not the prettiest machine I've ever done. Her top coat certainly is in pretty crappy condition, but at least we got the dirt off of her. Top coat is actually peeling pretty bad, so I'm not going to go any farther on the exterior cleaning because I want to keep the decals intact. But she does work nice. I've got her all back together, and she does make a pretty stitch. And even enough in reverse, so she's gonna do well. She goes back to the thrift shop at the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association tomorrow. But as you can see, that doesn't look bad at all on both sides. So I'm quite happy with the way she turned out. I will wipe her down. I'll probably put a little bit of wax on top of this yet before she goes back tomorrow. I really wish the clear coat wasn't in such bad shape, but it is what it is, and I'll wipe her down some more, get some more grime off of her. But, actually, you know what? Nah, that's just wiping off. That's just wiping off. Shellac is all that's doing. That's shellac coming off that we're seeing here. So I'm not going to do that anymore. But I'm going to take a camera with me tomorrow, and I'm going to shoot some video of her going back and of the thrift shop's reaction of her homecoming. Well, here it is. It's Thursday evening. Liz and I just got back a little while ago from delivering that 15-91 to the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association's thrift store. That's Ann's thrift store in Leonardo, New Jersey. Unfortunately, Kat, who's the general manager, she runs the thrift shop and she's like the operations manager for the organization, she got a little camera shy. But we do have some footage installing it back into the cabinet and of the machine running. So here you go. Well, the day has come. The 15-91 is back at the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association thrift store, Ann's thrift store in Leonardo, New Jersey. Just putting it back into the cabinet now, and then we'll get her running.
Of course, the first step is to get the lollipop hinges tightened up, and as anybody who's ever put one of these machines into a cabinet, getting to those screws for the set screws for the lollipop hinges is no kind of fun sometimes. And then putting the freshly rewired foot controller, get that down on the floor, we're going to feed that wire back up through the lift assist, get it through that little hole there, got the wire through. and we'll take the power block off. And here you'll see why I'm a little bit more generous with the motor and lamp wires than Singer was at the factory. I like to be able to take these things and hold them in a comfortable position. And sometimes the little bit of wire that Singer used, I mean, they cut that close. Just doing this simple operation here can be a pain in the neck. So removing terminals 1 and 2 for the foot controller, of course, and putting those nice new ring terminals on with their little shrink-wrapped ends, and getting the plastic nut conductor nuts back on. But yeah, try doing that with the little amount of wire that Singer used, and it's just not a pleasurable experience. So yeah, adding an inch or two of wire is no big deal. So with all that in place, making sure they're all nice and tight, putting the power block back on, and get the screw in, get the screw tightened up, and that's pretty much all this machine needed to get her all buttoned up. And feed the wire back through and close her down. There we go. And fortunately, no, unfortunately, when I was putting the machine in the cabinet, I knocked the needle plate off. So just popping that back in place real quick. Put a piece of cloth under that, and it's time to get power cord plugged in.
Rewired power cord. There's no place to plug this in here, obviously.
Yeah, right here.
Oh, is there?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. You'll be able to see her run. Okay.
Well, I need a picture of you guys with it.
All right. Now, well, let's here we go. It. Foot controller. The light comes on. Ta-da.
Very exciting.
And it goes reverse.
Get your hand out of the way. Bob, get your hand out of the way.
What do you think?
Wow.
What do you think?
So cool.
Are we a happy?
Right.
Are we
move out of the way, Bob.
If you get any more of these, you call me. I'll take care of them for you.
Wow. All
right. Well, there you have it. That's all I've got for you this week. I'd like to thank whoever donated that machine to the New Jersey Blind Citizens Association's thrift shop. It was a nice thing to be able to work on, and now the thrift shop can sell that machine without fear of whoever buys it plugging it in, either getting electrocuted or burning their house down. And that really was the goal. Everything else I did on that, well, that was just because I can't stand to see a machine not run right. But anyway, whoever donated that machine to the thrift shop, thank you very much. Kat did tell me a little bit of the backstory. Apparently, the woman who donated the machine, it was her mother's machine. Her mother had passed on. So hopefully, you know, whoever uses that machine in the future will think of that woman's mom and smile, you know. But anyway, that's all I've got for you for this week. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.